Good evening. I'm glad to be back in Beit Gavriel after almost 2 years. Since I used to give lectures here, they renovated the place. It's a new face, Baruch Hashem. And I see some faces from the past already, Baruch Hashem. May we have a lot more people coming. And I have many, many different topics that we can speak about. I usually like to speak according to the crowd that I see in front of me. That's why it doesn't pay for me to prepare ever a lecture, because I never know what I'm going to see. Sometimes I see beginners, sometimes I see people who already keep mitzvot, and sometimes I see a mixture, and that's the hardest part, to give a lecture that everyone will go happy. The beginners and those who are already in. So that's what we're going to do tonight. We are just, as you know, for those who know, we are now entered, minutes ago, Tu Be'av, the 15 days of Av. Av is one of the bad months of the year. It's the month when the Holy Temple was destroyed twice in history, once by the Babylonians, once by the Romans. For those who know Jewish history, it's not only Jewish history, it's the whole world history. It's serious tragedies happening every year in this month of Av. Mamash, terrible things happen. I'll just give you an example. 3 weeks ago, when the 3 weeks of Ben HaMetzarim started, I spoke in Or Natan and I told the people, be very careful in these 3 weeks, especially in the week of Tisha B'Av, because the nature is very nervous. And there are things that usually in irregular parts of the year are not so dangerous. They are becoming extremely dangerous in the week of Tisha B'Av. I said it in another place in New Jersey, and somebody was not so happy to hear about it. He told me, how can you prove it? So I told him, very simple. If you go to Israel on the day of Tisha B'Av, on the week of Tisha B'Av, you try to enter into the water. The water do not reach your knees, and it's hard for you to stand. If you make a few more steps, you're not going to be able to return. It could be a death sentence. All year, you can go all the way in. You can go 100 yards inside the water. It's almost no danger. You make 5-10 steps into the water, you feel the water pulling you inside, and you have no strength to resist the water. Every year, a repeat, for those who know a little bit how the ocean behaves in Israel, mamash, you see the hand of God and a creation. And if you're still not convinced, just to give you an idea, this week of Tisha B'Av, 4 guys dried out to death. They went on a trip, and they just didn't have enough water, and they died. 4 guys in 1 week. Dehydrated. You believe such a thing? All year you don't have 4 people that goes on places and they die because of they didn't have enough water. In less than 4 days, 4 guys just from that dying. And this is not people who don't know how hot it is. They are well prepared. They went to places. They know it's about 110 degrees over there. They brought water. Nobody can explain. 4 guys died. Why? Because this is a very serious time. A lot of people drown in the ocean. Baruch Hashem, we're behind it. We just passed it. After the 3 week passed, we read in the shul the haftara. What does it mean, haftara? Haftara means in the time of the Romans, when the Romans occupied the Holy Land, they did not allow the Jews to learn Torah. Throughout history, the goyim, the non-Jews, always knew that the strength of the Jews is the Torah that they receive from God. How did they know? They witness it. The Gentiles, the nations, the goyim, none of them ever claimed that the Jews never received Torah from Hashem. We should know history. Not only they do not deny it, they admit 100% that the Jews received Torah in Mount Sinai. They playing tricks. They claim they also got a book, they also had a prophet, Muhammad, JC, whatever. But they admit that Judaism is 100% valid. So, they knew that the power of the Jews is the gift that God gave to the Jews. 13.2 million Jews in a world with 6.4 billion goyim, and the Jews, in a way, are involved in every transaction in the creation. Everywhere you go. In every government, every advisor, every minister, there's always around Jews, religious, non-religious. The Torah already said, everybody will speak about you from the day I created the world until the day the world will be destroyed. Everything is around you because the world was created for the nation of Israel. Even before we became Israel, we were only Hebrews. Still, the Torah says, I created the world for my children, the nation of Israel, as we're going to see in a parasha that we read yesterday. I'm going to analyze the parasha word by word almost, and you'll be amazed. Maybe some of us read it a few times in our life, but we didn't pay attention to the details, what I'm going to show you tonight. But I would like to start with the haftarah. First of all, I would like to explain what haftarah means. Haftarah means a parallel part from the prophets that is almost equal in the subject to the part, to the parasha, to the chapter that we read in the Torah. Why do we have to read apart from the prophet? It wasn't mandatory, because in the time of the Romans, they knew that if the Jews learn Torah or they read in the Torah in Shul, that's what gives them the strength and connection with their God. And that's not good for us, the Goyim. Therefore, rule number one, Jews are not allowed to learn Torah. So they came and they made an announcement. Every Jew will be learning Torah, will be executed. So the Jews, they saw that it's a life risk. So what did they do? They came to the Romans and they said, okay, you don't want us to read the Torah, so at least let us read what our rabbis told us. Human being, not God, human being. They fooled them. And they said, what do you mean? They say, look, here, this is Isaiah, this is Jeremiah, this is Yoel. What do you care? We read. They wrote us all kinds of Musar, you know, lectures they gave us. They said, okay, no problem. That's no problem. You can read it. What did they do? They were very clever. They took something from the prophets that remind the public about the subject of the parasha. Why did they do it? Because they knew in hundreds of years, if the Jews will not read every Shabbat in a parasha, they'll forget about this tradition. It will be disappeared completely. Thanks to that, we're still reading today in the Torah. However, when the Romans disappeared, right? And the Jews were able back in Eretz Israel to go back and read in the Torah. Why they continue to read in the prophets? As a memory for the decrees that we had. None of the tradition that we have in our background are we allowed to cancel. The great things, the great power that Judaism has is that we were very careful in our traits and in our tradition, in our halakha, the laws, the Jewish law, and all the fences that the rabbis made around the Torah, we kept them originally 100%. The reason is because the rabbis knew that if they're going to change one rule, one simple rule, which really does not apply anymore, it's not relevant anymore, 100%, it's not relevant. But if we're going to show our children that we are able to cancel some of the laws that they made, you know what's going to happen in 2-3 generations? They will cancel everything. This is the nature of human being. You open a little door for him, you give him one finger, we say in Hebrew, he wants the entire hand. You give him one hand, he wants two hands. You give him two hands, it's not enough. It's never enough. The Gemara says, he has 100, he wants 200. He has 200, he wants 400. That's the nature of our evil inclination. So we have haftarot, after 2,000 years, we still read it. Now let's see what the prophet had to tell us in the haftarah, which we read in the shul yesterday. It's very interesting. Pay attention. First of all, it starts with Nachamu, Nachamu Ami. I'm calling my nation. This is, of course, the word of God. The Romans did not know that when the prophet came and spoke, everything he said was not his idea. It's all what God told him to say. That's what they did not know. But we know it. So let's see what God wanted to tell us after the destruction of Beit HaMikdash, after those three terrible weeks when we are disconnected from Hashem, comes the prophet and says like this, Nachamu, Nachamu, Ami, Omar Elokechem. I came to comfort you. Do not be depressed. It's not the end of the world. It's a bed. You lost the holy temple. It was the house of God. As the Torah say, build me a house in Jerusalem on the mountain, and my spirit will always be there. People will see the miracles of God every day in Beit HaMikdash. We are very amazed by Hanukkah miracle. Why? It was a huge miracle. You should know that miracles like Hanukkah, you have every 2-3 minutes in Beit HaMikdash all year around. All year around. If you had doubts if God exists or if God is participating in everything that happens here in nature, All you had to do is walk with your ride your horse to Jerusalem, which take you maybe a day or two. You get there, you go inside, you see what's going on, the miracles in Beit HaMikdash, you couldn't believe. Tons of meat, they butcher the animals, never saw one fly inside. The smoke goes direct line all the way up to heaven. It even when a windy day, the smoke stays always in one line. It's interesting. The music goes for all over Israel. And so many other miracles that were taking place over there, that even the person that was a complete non-believer could not deny that there's a magic here. Something is going on. Once we lost the Beit HaMikdash, the Torah says that there will be time in a Jewish history that God is hiding himself from us and we cannot see him anymore in a creation. It's very difficult. But if you really want to see him, you're always going to be able to see him. Pay attention to what I'm going to read. So he says like this. The Navi says, the same way everything was destroyed, there will be time that God will gather all the Jews back into the Holy Land and will build for us the third Beit HaMikdash, the third Holy Temple, which will be the final one and the permanent one until the entire world will be destroyed. But as long as this world exists, the third Beit HaMikdash cannot be destroyed anymore, like the first and the second. Once the third Beit HaMikdash will be build in Jerusalem, that's of course the time of Mashiach, and that's after the resurrection of the dead, after all the brilliant and beautiful prophecies that we have in the Torah, they're all going to come through. We're going to have the best time in history. Why? Because there used to be few great times in the life of human being on this earth. One of the best time, which was only few minutes, was after God created Adam. The evil inclination that we have today in our heart was not in his heart. It was an external power, not internal power. Today, when you have a temptation for something, it's very hard to stop yourself because you feel it coming from your heart, from inside. It's burning. It's bothering you from the inside. It doesn't leave you alone until most of the time you're going to fail and do it, make the sin. In the time of Adam, it was an external thing. Then, after he made the sin, it entered his body. Adam was supposed to live forever, should never die. Because of the sin, God told him, after you're going to eat from the tree, you're going to die. That's why we're dying today. Millions of people dying every day, all over the world for 5,767 years because of one fruit that he ate. One piece of grapes, bunch of grapes he ate from the tree. And how many people die because of one little act? Pay attention to what's going on here. Next thing is, the world changed completely. Everything that you have today is different because he did not listen to God in the first day of his creation. The world would be completely different, so much easier than before, that if we would know how much we lost from the sin of Adam, we will not stop to cry about that sin. But however, we are not so knowledgeable. For those who knows how the world should have been before the sin of Adam, it's really a waste. Such a tragedy that he ate from the tree. One test God gave him in his life, that's all. It was created on Friday afternoon, close to Shabbat, and then moments before Shabbat he made the sin and everything turned around. Now, since now we are after the time of Beit HaMikdash, there will be time, God says, that he will bring Mashiach, and that will be the beginning of the salvation. There was also one good period of time when the Jews have the first and the second Beit HaMikdash, and also one other thing, in the Exodus of Egypt, for a period of 1 year, the Jews were like kings. They were standing and watching all the miracles God made in Egypt, and we came out and we received the Torah 49 days after the Exodus of Egypt. And later, 40 years later, we entered the land and we built the first and the second Beit HaMikdash. There were great times in Jewish history. However, the last 2,000 years, we're going in reverse. Every generation is a little bit worse than the previous one. Until today, unfortunately, and I say it with pain in my heart, sharp pain, today we are in a situation, unfortunately, that close to 80% of the Jewish people in the world do not know one word from Judaism. First of all, Rabbi Ovadia Yosef said 2-3 years ago in Israel, Shimon, you're going to need a lot more chair. I'm preparing you already, so, you know. Bezrat Hashem. So, Baruch Hashem. So, Rabbi Ovadia Yosef said, how can I go to sleep at night when there's a million kids in Israel don't know how to say Kriyat Shema before they go to bed? Million kids in Israel grow up Chas V'Shalom like Goyim. They don't know. It's not their fault. They're not wicked. They're born into an environment that their parents themselves don't know anything about Judaism. It's already third or fourth generation that the Jews really got disconnected completely from God. Some intentionally, some not intentionally, but that's reality. We have a great responsibility, each one of us that know even a little bit, or even if you don't know, you have the power to make an impact on returning those Jews to our Father in heaven. It's the biggest and the most important and the most urgent mitzvah. You should know it. The number one in the list before any mitzvah. It's so important that I just saw recently a book that somebody sent a question to the biggest rabbi of the generation, and he asked him, he passed away about 7 years, Rav Ben Sion Abba Shaul, Alav HaShalom, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, and he asked him a question. A person that have to save a Jewish boy from an anti-religious environment. In Israel it's called kibbutz. You know, over there they made it's like a communist town, you know, it's based on communism because they brought it from Russia. Is he allowed to do Chilulei Shabbat, to be Mechalel Shabbat, to save him? And he answered him, yes. I once asked a big rabbi, and he asked me not to publish his name because he's afraid from the criticism. I told him, what happens if 15 minutes before a seminar begins? We have seminars Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and sometimes it goes through Monday. And in those seminars, usually every Jew that comes and have doubts if the Torah is correct or not, usually he lives with no doubts whatsoever. He knows it's 100% the Word of God, and now it's about time to wake up. Usually, it's always an exception to the rule once in a while of people who did not participate in the lecture, but usually people get convinced 100% scientifically without a doubt. So I ask him, what happened if 15 minutes before Shabbat you finally convince one guy to go to the hotel, but it's 2 hours ride? Are you allowed to drive him on Shabbat to the seminar? He told me, yes. Find a cab, a goy, give him the money before Shabbat, and tell him that this is the hotel where you have to get. When you get there, he's going to open the door for you, bring the bags in. You call them in advance that they prepare you a room. The goy will bring the things into the hotel, and it's a mitzvah to do it. And Shabbat, fine, even though it's not. It's not Shabbat. Shabbat is the foundation of Judaism, the covenant that we made with God. Saving souls is more important. Kol ha-matzil nefesh achat mi-Israel, someone who saved a Jewish soul, it counts like he saved the entire world. It's not a joke here. Save the entire world, you understand? If you had an opportunity to save the entire world, how happy you would be. Thanks to me, everybody lives here. Thanks to me. The world is mine, I saved the world. If somebody was about to press 100 buttons and send 500 atomic bombs all over the world, and you hold his hand, and you prevented it, how great your life will be from this moment on. You'll never forget that. You will not go to sleep for a year from excitement. Everybody will see on the street and he will be not nice to you. Say, hey, don't dare to talk. You're living thanks to me. The Torah says, if you save one Jewish soul in 70 years, for Hashem you save the entire world. Why Hashem gave such a reward? He was in a good mood to send so many gifts to people. Because he wanted to show you the value of one Jew. But he did not say saving a Jew from death. No. Saving the soul, nefesh. Nefesh. Saving a soul of a Jew, bringing him back to the truth, to our Father in heaven. So, back to what I started with. Another good time in Jewish period was after Rabbi Yosef Karo wrote Shulchan Aruch 500 years ago in the city of Tzfat. All the Chachamim, there was a lot of Chachamim 500 years ago in the city of Tzfat. It was a great time for the Jews in the Holy Land until later there was a huge earthquake, erased the entire place. And since then, 500 years, we are now, right now. We are entering now the most important time in a creation. We are now 17 years in the last quarter from 24 quarters of the creation. The last quarter from 24, 23 parts are behind us. We are 17 years in the last quarter from 24 quarters. Remember what I said. We are 5,767. The world is set for 6,000 years. Chazal says in the 6,000 and not in the end, Mashiach will come. Chazal says at least 200 years before the end. That means in 33 years, approximately everything you read in the Torah for 2,000 years, every day, every week is about to happen. And what's going to happen really? I have a whole lecture about it. Maybe we'll do it next week. But for that, you need really 500 people because it's a magnificent, it's unbelievable lecture. It's such a fascinating topic because you're going to see what's going to happen in the world. You'll be amazed what Hashem is preparing us after 2,000 years of suffering. Just to give you a preview, there will be periods of righteous people through history that you know their names, King David, Moshe Rabbeinu, Aaron, his brother, that's starting to wake up and resurrect and come back to life. And we will establish the third Beit HaMikdash in Yerushalayim. And the goyim that will be left in the world would say, will announce, there is only one truth, the truth of the Jews and their God. There will not be any contradiction. Today you have 80,000 religions and cults. 80,000 religions and cults. Almost every hour as we speak, somebody will make up a new cult. By the end of this lecture, you have 80,001, if not already happened. This is reality. Bayom ahu yeh Hashem echad u'shmo echad. There will be one God with one name. Nobody will call him God, G-O-D. Even though G-O-D in numeric value, it's also 26. Interesting. The goyim made up a name, God. Where did they bring it from? I don't know. But in Hebrew, Yud-Kei Vav-Kei, it's 26. God is also 26 in numeric value. Allah came from El, right, in Hebrew. The Arabs, it's very similar to Hebrew. It's interesting. Ivrit and Aravit is the same letters. Ivri and Aravi. Aravi is Ishmaelim, the enemies of the nation of Israel. And Ivri is the same letter. We both came from Avraham Avinu. Why did they call themselves Aravi? We are Ivri. They saw we are Ivri. They cannot call themselves Ivri. So they play with the letters. They call themselves Aravi. Why they were so stubborn to stay in this name? Why do they care? Make yourself a new name. Because they knew the secret and the power of Avraham Avinu, that he was, God called him Avraham Ivri. Ivri means one-sided. He has the truth and everybody else live in illusion. Nobody knows the truth of life, the purpose of life. Avraham knew. That's why God loved him. What is the final sentence about Avraham Avinu in the Torah? I loved Abraham because he kept my Torahs and my laws. God say, I love him because he listened to everything I told him. 100%. No question asked. We're coming now into such great time. Hope to have the merit because we're going to have to put some efforts to have the merit to stay and to see all these miracles. But we have to know that we are coming into the best time in history. We're going to get to the level of Adam before he made the sin. All the righteous people who will resurrect to life, they will not give birth anymore. He's not going to need, because there's not going to be reincarnation anymore. Every time you have reincarnation, that the soul comes in a new body, that's because it came for another test. Once Mashiach comes, the test is over. No more repentance, no more Baalei Teshuva. Whoever is here, whoever resurrect, stay, no evil inclination, no fighting with the Yetzer Hara, none of this. And then Chazal says, and the Rambam writes in the last page in his book, the Jews will teach Torah to all the goyim. Which goyim will survive? Chassidei Umot HaOlam, the goyim that loved the Jews, the goyim that kept the seven laws that God gave Noah after the flood, 4,200 years ago, God destroyed the entire world and he kept eight people alive. Noah and his wife, his three sons and the three daughter-in-law. Eight people. And he told them there are seven laws to keep from now on. And those laws apply to every goy in the world. Chinese, Arab, Russian, Japanese. Everyone still have to keep seven laws up to now. Most of them don't know about it. But if they know, they must keep it 100%. We have 613 mitzvot. Unfortunately, more than half of them does not apply today because we don't have the Beit HaMikdash. But soon we're going to have the third Beit HaMikdash and life will be a lot better. Now, the prophet says like this. Pay attention. It says, Sum arom enechem. God call every Jew. Every day there's an echo come to the ear of every Jew. Some of us hear, some of us don't. Sum arom enechem uru mi bara ele. You want to find me? All you have to do is raise your eyes to heaven and see all the stars. What comes into your mind right away, if you're intelligent? Who made all this? Who is that superpower that was able to create such trillions of galaxies? Each star 1,000 times bigger than Earth. All of them are in movement, non-stop, in circles. Not one hit the other. You have to know one thing. In every given moment that we speak, we have such jeopardy around us that we are not even aware of it. If we were able to see a satellite picture of how many steroids, asteroids are falling next to the Earth and not hitting us, we wouldn't believe that such miracle is happening. I just give you an example. Imagine you have a basketball right here, standing in the air, turning around in the same speed the Earth is turning around in 1,700 kilometers an hour, about 1,100 miles an hour. That's the speed of Earth. And every 365 days and a little bit, it makes a complete circle around the sun while it's turning around itself. And of course, it's standing in the air. There's no foundation, no base, right? If it would move 1% towards the sun or 1% away from the sun, either we will freeze to death in a second or we will burn. One of the two, but we couldn't live here. If the Earth would move 1%, that's it, 0.5%, away from the sun, all the oceans in less than a second will be ice. And all of you will freeze like this, couldn't move. If you move a little bit towards the sun, everything will be fire. If somebody crazy will decide to burn all the forest of LA, of all over the United States, Russia, Israel, the next person will light a cigarette, the people that will try to breathe will not be able to breathe because we get the oxygen from how many trees there are in the world. God is supervising the number of the trees in every given moment. If one crazy person will decide to get rid of all the trees in one place, the people will not be able to breathe. But 5,767 years, everyone had oxygen for free everywhere. If there will be too many trees, because, you know, trees expand. All the trees you see, one give birth to the other, and the third, and the fourth. That's how it is. You light a cigarette, the whole world will go on fire. So many interesting things happening every second, the person never think about it. So the Torah comes and say, hey, dear Jew, wake up. You never saw me, yes. You live in the 21st century, but you have intelligence to pick up your eyes and watch the sky and start thinking. Is it possible that all run by itself? The answer is no. So here is the Navi. The Navi says, Sum arom enechem uru mi bara ele. One other thing in the Haftarah of yesterday that people don't pay attention, it says like this. Hayoshev al chug haaretz v'yoshveha kechagavim. 500 years ago, before Christopher Columbus went on his famous trip, the entire world were arguing if the world is flat or round. There was no final answer. They continued to argue for years and years and years. Came Christopher Columbus on his trip to India and he got to the same place. At that moment, 500 years ago, the scientific world stopped to argue if the world is flat or round. So when you go to college today, you ask the professor, excuse me, sir, who is the one who found out that the world is round? Everybody will answer, Christopher Columbus. So the next time when it happens to you, don't hesitate. Tell him, I'm sorry to correct you, professor. The Navi Yeshaya, the prophet Yeshaya, 2,600 years ago, wrote it and gave it to the Jews. And how did the Navi know about it? not because he was a scientist. He wasn't getting paid by NASA. Navi Ishaya. You know the story of Navi Ishaya, no? Navi Ishaya, he lived in a generation of King Hezekiah, the most successful king in the history of Judaism was King Hezekiah, 2600 years ago. The Gemara say in his generation, every little boy, you see that boy over there? You see how he playing now with his knees? In a generation of King Hezekiah, he already knew all the Mishnayot by heart. You come and ask him question about women in purity, in 6 years old, he was able to answer you what the Gdol Hador today hesitate. That's the generation of King Hezekiah. Not only that, the Gemara say the girls, nobody likes to say it, but the girls already knew almost the entire Torah in his generation. One day Hashem sent the prophet to him and say, excuse me, King Hezekiah, your time is up. You got Hashem angry, you have to die. So what did I do? He said, you never got married. I say, why don't I get married? Why, I don't want to have children? Of course I have. I have a holy vision, and I see that I'm going to have a wicked son. I don't want to bring a wicked son to the world. I'd rather be single. I don't want the agony and the pain to see that my son is away from God. I don't need. So he told him, you're not God. God said the first mitzvah in the Torah to get married and have children. At least one boy and one girl. That's pruvu, at least. That they're also able to give birth. If they're unable to give, if you have 10 girls and 10 boys, and God forbid all of them barren, you did not do the mitzvah. One person that have one boy, one girl, and they are able to give birth, that's the mitzvah. If you have 10 boys, you did not make the mitzvah. 10 girls, you did not make the mitzvah. 10 boys and 2 girls, but the 2 girls are barren, you did not make the mitzvah. It has to be at least one boy and one girl that are able to continue your descendants. And God forbid, if you had 10 boys and 10 girls, and they all went to a wedding somewhere on a plane, and God forbid the plane crashed, so you had the mitzvah up to that moment, and from this moment you lost it. So you may say, what is it, my fault? You're right. Some mitzvot, you need the merit for God to give you a gift. It's a gift, it's a bonus, it's not in your hand. You can try until tomorrow, and if God doesn't want, you'll never do it. How many people are dying to get married? They get to age 50 and they're still single? Because God didn't want them to get married, for whatever reasons. How many people are trying to have children? You think everyone is successful? 15% of the Jews in the world cannot have children. 15%. In a natural way. Today, Baruch Hashem, with all the inventions that the doctors have, it's a little bit easier. 15%, that means from every 100 couples, 15 have delays. 5 years, 8 years, 17 years, and sometimes forever. Delays to have children. So now, the Torah says like this. The Navi Ishaya, before that I'm going to finish the story, so the Navi Ishaya, he told him, you're about to die, and he told him, no, I did it for the sake of heaven. I say, I know, but you still had to listen to God. You cannot mix your own opinion when God gives you the orders. Put your opinion aside. You have to listen to the orders of the Creator of the world. He knows better than you what's good. Even though you think sometimes you do better for Him. He told you what to do, stick to the orders. So you know what happened? He told him, okay, I'm going to repent now. I sinned to Hashem, I admit, I made a mistake. I had good intention, but I made a mistake. So now I'm going to become righteous again. I'm going to correct my sin. Give me your daughter to be my wife. So the prophet got nervous. What do you mean I give you my daughter? Tomorrow you're about to die. You're asking me to marry my daughter. So he said, no, listen. This is where we learn that important sentence that we say all our life. Chazal say, Afilu cherev chada munachat al tzavaro shel adam al ityayesh min harachamim. Translation. Even a sharp sword is on the neck of a Jew moments before his death. Moments, seconds. He cannot lose hope. He's not allowed to lose hope. God, if God wants, in 1 second, everything can turn around. There was one famous story of two Jews, two friends, true friendship. One Jew, the king caught him doing something, and he wanted to execute him, the goy. So he told him, what is your last request? Usually before they execute people, they give them the last request. So obviously he didn't ask for a slice of pizza like today. or a steak. It was a little bit more clever. He say, I have something to do in my hometown. I have to go. I'm going to write my will for my children, for my wife, to tell her that I'm not coming back. So he said, where do you live? He said, in that town. He said, oh, that's going to take a month to go back and forth. I don't have patience. I want to kill you today. So he said, my friend will be your collateral. Keep him in your hand. If I don't come, you'll kill him. What do you care? You want to kill someone? Believe me, he's not going to volunteer to die for me. I'm going to return. So the king asked the other Jew, are you willing to do it? He said, yes, I trust him. He's 100%. So, okay, put him in prison. By the time the month arrived, he was supposed to get there at 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock, everybody is waiting in the center of the town, waiting for the Jew to arrive. He look around with the binoculars all over. Nobody is showing up. 2:10, 2:20, 2:30, they see somebody coming on a donkey from far away. So the king got angry. How does he have the nerve to come, to come so late? So he says to the Jew, I'm sorry, even when my friend arrives here, we're going to kill you. That's it. He said, listen, life and death is in the hand of God. Whatever you decide, you decide. That's what he answered. So when the Jew came, he said, how do you have the nerve to come half an hour late? He had a whole month. So I told him, listen, I got stopped, they stopped me on the road, I didn't pay toll, I didn't have enough money, I had to return, make up a story. And then he said, okay, we're going to kill your friend. So then one of the advisors say, hey, your majesty, it's not fair. What is this guy? This guy is really not the criminal. Maybe we should kill the criminal. So the king, okay, say, you know, you're right, we'll start with you. So he said, no. The other guy said, no, it's not fair. You have to kill me, the friend said, not him. Say, no, you have to kill me. They've been fighting already for an hour. Me, no, you have to kill me. Usually it's the other way, kill him. Say, no, you got to kill me. He said, no, what do you mean? They started to fight. So the king said, I like these two guys. Not only I'm not going to kill you, I want you to work for me in a palace here. And both got saved. And that's the same king, he had a case. When one Jew came to work for him, he was a very cruel king. And when someone used to serve him, if you work for him as a waiter, people's hands were shaking. Why? Because he's such a crazy, fanatic king that if by mistake you make one mistake as a waiter, one drop will fall on the table or something, he gives you such an angry look, everybody around knows it's your last day in life. That's it. Nothing will help. So one Jew, he needed a job. He was paying good, it's the king. So he served soup to the king. They had a meal, all the important people. And when the poor guy came to serve the soup, one spark flew from the pot into his shirt. The king looked at that, he gave him such a look. Everybody told the Jew, prepare your grave. So guess what happened? So the Jew took the whole soup, spill it to his face, to all over his shirt. So the king get up like this in front of hundreds of people. Everybody say, oh, no. Something like this never happened in the history. So he said, king start to scream, take him away right away. We're going to hang him right away. So he cannot wait an hour even. He runs like this with his dirty clothes. He want to see how they hang the Jew. Just moment before they hang him, the king say, wait a minute, stop. I want to see how this chutzpah, 16 years old, have the nerve to spill the soup on purpose on me. I want to speak to him for a few minutes. So he get up to the stage over there and he say, listen, tell me what's going on here. It's a little bit, doesn't make sense. How did you spill the soup in my face? So the Jew, that's what the Ben Ish Chai say, Chaim v'mavet b'yad ha-lashon. Life and death depend on what's going to come out next from your mouth. The Jew told him, your majesty, we are Jewish people. In our halachot, it says that in every country we're going to live, one of the most important rules is to give great respect for the king. He gave him an example. When we say Kriyat Shema, if a king comes in the middle, we're not allowed to stop for anything in the world in Kriyat Shema. But if you would come into the synagogue in the middle, for you, we would stop and say hello to you. That's the halacha in Shulchan Aruch. So I tell you something. I wanted to serve you the soup. What can I do? A spark flew in your shirt. You gave me the look. Everybody know you're going to kill me, and I'm innocent. I didn't do anything. So I wanted to be guilty. I wanted to give a reason that you should really kill me, that after my death nobody would want to rebel against you. And they say, what a cruel king we have. For one spark he killed that innocent boy. So I spilled everything on you. Now I deserve to die. Nobody will speak Lashon Hara about you tomorrow. I save your honor. That's what was in my mind. So the king say, you are my number one man from now on. He gave him the ring. Yosef, the new Yosef. Yeah, Ben Ish Chai brings it. He has a book about it. Ben Ish Chai. Back to our story. So the Navi, Yeshaya, say, how am I going to give you my daughter to be your wife? You're going to die in 24 hours. So he said, no, I'm not going to die. I'm going to pray to Hashem from now until Hashem will forgive me. And he started to pray. He went with his face to the wall and he started to pray. Comes the prophet to Hashem and says, Hashem, what am I going to do with him? What should I do? He says, Hashem say, go back to him and tell him I gave him 15 more years to live. 15 more years. He came back to the king. Hashem gave you 15 more years to live. He said, no, you're fooling me. I don't buy it so easy. You try to comfort me, no? He said, no, I'm serious. So he told him, give me a sign. You're the messenger of God. Give me a sign. So he told him, you see the sun? The sun will not set today on the right time. If it's supposed to be sunset, 8 o'clock, 10 o'clock, you still didn't see the sun. That's my sign to you. 4 times in history, Hashem made the sun and the earth and the moon system standing. Pause. 4 times in history. One in a war with Joshua. One of the things is right here. So what happened is, he gave him his daughter to marry him, and this Menashe, his son was Menashe. Don't get nervous, those who their name is Menashe, because there's also a lot of good Menashe in the Torah. It's good. And his son, his name was Menashe, perhaps the worst king in history. Put idols all over for the Jews to worship the idols. Such a wicked person. Worship every Avodah Zarah you can think of. And he knew that he's going to have such a son. And this is the son of King Chizkiyahu, the grandson of the prophet Yeshaya, 2600 years ago. And you know what? The prophet was speaking against his grandson, that is such a wicked king. And you know what? He sent his army to search for his grandfather, the most righteous person on earth, to kill him. And you know, the prophet Yeshaya, went to a huge tree and dug a hole inside the tree, and he hid himself inside the tree. And somebody came and told him, your grandfather is inside the tree. The head rabbi of the generation is hiding. Your grandfather is inside the tree. Such a wicked person. And he took his servants with a sword and cut him to pieces alive with the tree. That's how wicked he was. Why do I tell you this story? Because close to the end of his life, the Goyim made a war with us, with the Jewish nation, and they captured him. And they put him inside a big metal ball, and they lift him on a chain, and he was in the air, and they put fire underneath, and they started to hit the ball. And he was standing inside, and his feet are burning. He begins to jump, you know, it's burning. And now they're about to burn him inside that metal. He started to call all the idols that he knew. The God of this, the God of that, please save me, nothing helped. So he said like this, the God of Israel, if you hear me, if you're going to save me right now, I'm going to make full repentance, full tshuva, and become righteous. And the Tanakh, the Bible says that the ball started to rise from the heat. Of course, there's a miracle, but started to rise and fly away. And he got saved. And from that moment, he kept his word and he made the tshuva. This is what his father didn't see. His father never wanted to have a son because he saw all the bad things he does. But he didn't see that close to the end of his life, he made full repentance. And even a person like this is able to return to Hashem, we have a much better chance, no? We did not cut our grandfather, the head rabbi of the generation, with a sword. We will never dare to do it. But he made tshuva. Go back to the story. The Navi Yeshaya says like this. S'u marom enechem, please raise your eyes to heaven. Uru mi bara ele. He also said, היושב על חוג הארץ ויושביה כחגבים. חוג in Hebrew means something who moves in circles. חוג, מחוגה, you know מחוגה, how you make circles in geometry. 2600 years ago, the prophet Yeshaya already told the world is round. How did he know? There was no NASA. There was no pictures from satellite that the world is round, but it's right here in Haftarah. We read it in Shul yesterday. 2100 years before Christopher Columbus. I want to give a few more things about the parasha. Pay attention. This parasha is one of the most substantial parashot in the Torah. I don't like to say it so much because we're not really allowed to say that one parasha in the Torah it's more important than the other, because every letter of the Torah it's equally holy. It's the word of God. It's all one unit. You take one letter out from a different parasha, this parasha it's worthless. If you go to a different parasha and you take a little yud, what happened to the Torah? The Torah lost the holiness. When they want to send the Torah from Israel to America, what do they do? If they have a person that willing to keep it on him, on the plane, so they send it, and he's holding the Torah the entire flight. It's very difficult, because everybody has to respect the Torah in a plane. It's like becoming like a shul over there. He wants to get up, he has to give it to somebody. It's a big headache. So what do? They don't finish the Torah. They keep few letters in the end, and when it gets here, they write the last few letters, and the Torah becomes holy. What do we learn from here? Something that God order us, if we do it 99.999999% until tomorrow, maybe nothing. If it's divine, it has to be 100%. Divine is 100%. 99%, you modify it, you change it, count this parasha and give us a great warning. Lo tosifu ולא תגרעו על התורה. Do not add one letter to my Torah. Do not erase one letter from my Torah. Even if we will not change the meaning of the word at all. In Hebrew, there are many letters throughout the story that you can erase, and everybody will understand the story equally. That's the simple way of understanding the story. But if you only knew how many millions of secrets are in between the lines in every sentence that you read, you would faint from the brilliance of this divine Torah. One of the ways to be amazed is to see the equal codes in the Torah. There's a mathematical method, hidden codes with people that are living in today's generation that God hides their name inside the text. If you take one letter in the middle of the Torah, you may ruin the entire codes. One letter out. You did not change the topic, the subject. Everybody understand it. It's not holy. You can send it in a suitcase. They dump in Kennedy Airport. They take the Torah, boom, they throw it. Why? One yud is missing. It's not holy. One yud is missing. How many versions the New Testament have? Do you know? The Goyim wrote the New Testament about 1950 years ago, maybe less, 1900, and about 70 years after J.C. Penney passed away, they wrote the New Testament. I want to ask you a question. How many different texts the New Testament has? Who know? Huh? Shimon, they don't listen to kolyakov.org. I gave a whole lecture about Christianity. Huh? No, the difference between Judaism. 150,000 different New Testaments in a line from here to Tel Aviv. One next to the other. One book is different than the other. One book is different than the other. Why? When people copy, guarantee they're going to make at least one mistake in every text. At least one letter. If the book has 100,000 letters, isn't it normal that you're going to make one mistake from 100,000 letters? The Vav, you made it Yud, a little bit shorter by 1 millimeter. That's all. It already became a different letter. And your friend that copied from the original, he made a mistake in a different line, by a different letter, already 3 versions. Right away, in the same generation, 1,000 people copy, each one made mistake in a different letter.
Here you have 1,000 different books from the moment they started the false New Testament until they copy, 1,000 people sit and copy it with a feather, already 1,000 different books. But the Torah, the same Torah everywhere. The Torah of Beit Gavriel and the Torah of the Ashkenazim across the street is the same Torah. You go to the Torah, you read the same Torah. You know what's the difference? Thank you. The difference is here. Right here. You read it yesterday in a shul. You may not pay attention, but maybe I'm going to highlight that. It says, "Lo tosifu, lo tigreu." Be very careful. I will not forgive a Jew that writes the Torah and make mistake. No one is allowed to make mistake. You may come and say, "Hey, listen, God, I'm not an angel. The Torah have 304,805 letters, almost 305,000 letters, much longer than Christianity and Quran. How is it possible I'm going to write 305,000 letters without making mistake?" The answer is, first of all, you don't do it in one shot. You do it parts by parts. But every 7 years, they had a mitzvah when the king gathered the entire nation. It's called mitzvat hakel. Hakel, gathering. It's called gathering. And they take groups of Jews all over, and one person laying in a Torah, and everybody else check that they have the same text. If one of the people have a different text, excuse me, stop right there. I have it with Aleph, but I heard you read with Ayin. Now remember one thing. Today, we do not know how to speak Hebrew, the Lashon Kodesh. Even the Israelis that born in Israel, their accent is not authentic, not original. And most of the Israelis, even if they went to university, they don't have an idea about grammar. And when they pray or when they read Hebrew, they make so many mistakes. The more you learn in yeshiva after a few years, you become very sensitive from the way people talk. You may hear professors, prime ministers, they don't know how to speak simple language. The reason for that is because they don't pay attention to the grammar so much. But the grammar, it's a whole world. I give you an example. The music, when you pray, how you sound, it changed the entire meaning of the sentence that you say. I'll give you an example. I'm sure all of you say at least once in your life, Shema Israel, right? How does it start? Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha. Sometimes I go and I hear people, this is what they say. Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha. Right? You hear it all over? Right, that's how they taught you in school? Sarabadia, they say, right? I know, I hear my children how they sing. Ve'ahavta et Hashem, chas v'shalom, to speak like this. It's cursing Hashem like this. You know what does it mean, ve'ahavta? You have to say ve'ahavta. What's the difference? Same letters, same words, different music. Why? I tell you why. When you say ve'ahavta, that means you used to love Hashem. Not anymore. It's the opposite. Pay attention. You say ve'ahavta, that's a language of ordering somebody to do something. Hashem is ordering you to love him. That's the foundation of the beginning of the Torah. You want to have relationship with me, you have to love me. You may say, how can I love you? I don't see you, I don't smell you, I cannot touch you. You don't need to. With your five senses, you don't need to prove I exist. You know how you know it? With your wisdom. You see the brilliant creation. You must fall in love with me. You learn about your body. The prophet Iyov, which was a goy, Iyov wrote, I look at my flesh, at my body, and I don't see body. I see God. Where do you see God? I see the cells. I see the blood. I see the veins. I see the organs. I see so many millions of miracles in my body every second. How can I not see God? Is it coincidence? Why the nostrils are here? Why the nose is not upside down? Why? Coincidence? Because the rain will fall into your nose and choke you. Do you ever think about it? I give you another example. You see this bone in the nose? Those who are in boxing, they may not have it. But those who have the bone right here, you should know one thing. This bone and that
too hard for me to say it.
And that piece right here, the hard ones, were made from the same ingredients. Nobody in medicine can explain why in the last second of the transaction, here it became hard and here it stayed a little bit softer. You know why? Imagine if it would be hard like the bone, you couldn't sleep. You put your head on a bed, it's like somebody put a gun to your head. A bone right here, you cannot sleep all your life. Everything you need, Hashem thought about. There's not one thing in your body that there's not a brilliant thought in it. But some people are blind, they don't see it. Some people are blind. They see it, but they're not really paying attention. So let's go back to here. It says like this, be very careful, do not add one letter to the Torah, do not erase one letter. Do not mix your personal opinion. Today in the morning, I was in Englewood. Every Saturday night, I skip the night of sleep and I go to Englewood. There's a group of people over there, and somebody has a big house. They're waiting for me in the middle of the night. We go, we do tikkun chatzot, we pray, and then we have huge arguments over there after the prayer. There's a very brilliant, famous lawyer over there. Like a shark, this guy. He speaks mamash, you know, like when Chazal said, who is a typical apikores? Mamash, it's amazing how brilliant a person can be in one way and how he uses brilliance to try to go against Chazal in everything that comes out of his mouth. So today, he said something like this. It says that every mitzvah, it depends on how you translate it, how you understand it. He said, you will tell me that this mitzvah means X, and I can prove to you that it means Y. So I told him, after you gave a beautiful speech here, one thing, you're misleading the crowd. You forgot that God gave the authority only to the chachamim, to the righteous, to the educated rabbi of each generation to decide what to do and how to do. Where does it say it in the Torah? Kol asher yomru lecha tishma bekolam. Everything the rabbis will tell you based on this Torah. Al pi haTorah hazot, tishma bekolam. If he tells you, according to my opinion, this is the right way to do the mitzvah, we don't care about your opinion, rabbi. Thank you, with all the respect. You're a smart person. But Hashem said, kol asher yorucha al pi haTorah hazot. In few times in history, when great Jews mixed their own opinions in the understanding of the Torah, a tragedy came to the world, such as King Solomon. Hashem said, "You should not. A king should not have more than 18 wives, maximum. It's more than enough." King Solomon married 1,000 wives. What was the reason? Does he really need 1,000 wives? Who is the fool who's going to think that King Solomon is hungry for women, that he needs 1,000 wives? Even the worst psycho in the world doesn't need 1,000 wives. Even Bin Laden only have 36 wives. You know? It's enough. He's got tired. How many? 16? What, they died, 20 of them? He has about 150 children, you know? Yeah. But the point is, what was the idea behind it? He wanted to marry every prince, every princess from every nation, convert her to Judaism, teach her Torah, and send her right back to her father to teach them Judaism. His goal was that in a period of 20, 30 years, every goy in the world will really be a Jew. That's what was in his mind. Righteous person. King Solomon is the smartest person ever lived. 12 years old, he was a king already. Hashem came to him in a dream and said, what do you want? Ask me. He told me, give me a decent and honest and intelligent brain to know how to judge your nation fairly. Other kings may ask, give me billions. Give me a strong army. Give me many years in kingdom. No, that's not what he cared about. Young boy, 12, before Bar Mitzvah. He said, I want to be a fair judge. Hashem said, because you didn't ask to take revenge against your enemies, because you didn't ask for wealth,
because you didn't ask for anything else, I'm going to give you everything. Wisdom, you're the smartest person, wealth, fame, everything that you didn't ask, you get. Budget deal. And that's how the famous trial came, that two wives were fighting about the baby, and he said, okay, let's chop the baby to two halves, $9.99, buy one, get one free. And that's how he became famous, and everybody started to respect him. After that court case that came to him, from that moment on, is the spirit. And what happened? He married 1,000 wives, and you know what was the end of his life? Everything he did for the sake of Hashem, the poor guy, King Solomon. The last sentence in his life, Vayas hara b'enei Hashem. And he did the bad in the eyes of Hashem. What a stain in your record, forever. Forever. He goes in the upper world, he is different than others. He has a stain. Every time, you cannot erase it. That's it, he died. He cannot make repentance after your death. It says, his women turn his heart away from God. King Solomon, to write such a thing? I want to ask you a question. Why Hashem did not erase that part from the Bible? Why? After all, he lived such great life, King Solomon. He did so many mitzvot. So many good things happened to the Jews in his time. Put one sentence, 10 words. Get it off the record. Why everyone has to know that he went after this goyot? Why? Such an embarrassment. Malbin pnei chavero barabim, no? Because the Torah, it's a divine book. In divine book, there's no exaggeration and no lies. It's 100% objective. You open up the Quran, you'll never find one indication that Muhammad once made a mistake in his life. Not one bad remark about him. He was more perfect than God himself, according to the Quran. Why? Because human beings like me and you, a liar wrote it. He's not going to write anything about his hero. He wants him to be divine. So he wrote that he's perfect. The Christians never wrote one bad comments about J.C. Penney until he went bankrupt a few years ago. You know, they never wrote anything bad about him. Perfect, he knows everything, he's mamash perfect. You read about Moshe Rabbeinu, the Torah described 5 sins that he made. Hashem got angry at him, you're not going to enter the land. It's this parasha yesterday. Go up to the mountain, I'm going to show you all the generation that will live here, but you will not enter the land. Moshe Rabbeinu, Va'etchanan el Hashem, it's 515 prayers. The Torah says Moshe Rabbeinu is shaking the gates of heaven. All the angels are panicking from his prayers, Chazal says. Hashem comes and shut his mouth. He said, Rav Lach, be quiet. Not one more word. You're going to destroy the world with your prayer. Moshe Rabbeinu said to Hashem, okay. You don't want to let me enter the land. I was able in one prayer to save the entire Jewish nation. 515 prayers, I cannot save my own life? Where is the justice here? One time you told me, leave me alone, I'm going to destroy, chas v'shalom, the entire Jews, and I'm going to take you and make a new nation from you. What? I told you, chas v'shalom, Hashem, if you want to destroy the Jews and make from me a new nation, erase my name from your book. And you say, okay. I surrender. No problem. I'm not going to destroy them. Now I come, I ask you only to let me enter the land 515 times. You don't let me in? Okay, so let me go in as an animal, as a bird, as a cow. Reincarnate me in a cow. Let me enter the land as a cow. What do you need to be a cow? Moshe Rabbeinu wants to be a cow. You know why? Chazal says that one Talmid Chacham will take that cow, slaughter it, and eat me and a Shabbos table. At least I knew I was in the Holy Land. Entering the Holy Land, Chazal say a person, every 4 steps he makes in the Holy Land, it's a mitzvah. Chazal say the brain of the person is much smarter in Israel than all over the world. There's great influence on your thoughts and your intelligence when you're in the Holy Land. Avira de Eretz Israel machkim. The oxygen that you breathe in Eretz Israel affects your genes and your brain better than any other place in the world. But at the same time, your sin in Eretz Israel are much heavier. You are in the living room of the creator of the world. It's different behaving. Different behaving. Chazal says, Kol Adar b'chutz la'aretz. Someone who lives in overseas and is happy about it, and is not anxious to make aliyah to the Holy Land, is chas v'shalom, someone who lives with no God. Once I remember, I was in Yerushalayim, and my cousin's husband, he told me, "No, when are you going to join us here in Yerushalayim?" That was more than 10 years ago. So I told him, what are you talking about? You know, I live in a place, Muncie, everybody religious. What do I need to come here, you know? 10 years ago. So he said, okay, listen. The fact that you don't want to come is one thing. The fact that you don't cry about it, that's much worse. You see what he told me? He told me, okay, there's one thing that you're a fool. You don't want to come to Yerushalayim because you don't understand 1 second in Yerushalayim as opposed to 1 second in Muncie or anywhere else in the world. But the worst news is that you don't even feel that it's bad. That's the problem. This is the Ramchal. I once said in one of the lectures, the Ramchal said there are two people who live in the darkness. Two people. One is very, very happy, and one is very upset. Why? We're both in the darkness. One is upset because he just found out that he lived in mistake. He just found out that his life is not according to the rules of the Creator. I live like an animal. I have no rules. I have no guideline. I don't know the purpose of life. Whatever I feel like, I'm doing like an animal in a field. The other person is still not aware of it. So he's very happy about his life. He goes to disco, he drives with his car on Friday night, music all over, you know, some Bukharian music on 108 Street, Friday night, cigarette in his mouth, tons of gel in his hair, 5 earrings on the right ear. and he looks at the religious people in his eyesight and says, oh, miserable guys, look at them. Look, this guy, remember him from the days of the beach. Look what he became. Right? True or not? This is reality. Did you check if he's right or you're right? Check. How can you jump to conclusion before you check? What kind of businessman you are? Somebody offer you a deal of a lifetime. You don't open the page to read. Somebody came and put a notebook on your book. Dedicate 3 days. You become a billionaire. 3 days. You don't open it. You're a smart person. So 3 days? Worth for me to be a billionaire? Even if there's 1% chance you're right. 3 days, big deal. I live 70, 80 years. I know 3 days. It was worth to try, no? People run 70 years after money with a chance to 1 to 1,000, maybe they make it. They never get tired. After hundreds of disappointments and aggravations, they never get tired. I once met a guy, Scottish, in the days that I used to be in business. He came to my office. One day I see 80 years old man, Graham Martin Brown. That's his name. Maybe he's not alive anymore. That was 15 years ago. He was 80 then. He comes to my office with a skirt. Skirt? Yeah, skirt. You know, the Scottish people, they walk with a skirt. I see an old man. I never knew it. I see a man with a dress. He comes. He begins to talk to me. This, we became friends. I used to walk with him in the streets of Manhattan. I try to stay 5 steps behind him, you know. The people won't see that he's my friend, this guy. Maybe they think he's my grandfather or something, you know. Walk with him, and everyone looks around, you know. It's something unique. He never got tired of becoming rich. 80 years old, he's killing himself. Telephones, meetings, running to another meeting. Let's go to Boston. Let's go to Miami. 80 years old. I was wondering, where is this hunger come from? Dedicate 2-3 days. Log on. Call yaakov.org. Prove. Torah anytime. That's it? No? TorahAnytime.com. You go in. Prove. Proof. Part one. Proof part B. 3 hours. That's it. Not 3 days. 3 hours. Yes or not? God gave it or not? If God did not give it, put it in the toilet. It's nothing, it's history book. If God gave it, how much you're losing every second? Common sense, yes or no? If God did not give it, you're a fool that you're listening to it. The biggest fool, you're wasting your time. Go do whatever you want. But if God gave it, how can you live 1 second without it? You have a purpose, you're not a dog. If God wanted you to be a chimpanzee, he would make you a chimpanzee. I'll tell you a story. It reminds me about the chimpanzee. Somebody told me, in order for you to be a good speaker, you must say a joke every 5 minutes. I told him, my point in life is not to be a clown. You know, we have Avi the clown. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Avi the clown is back in town. Everyone has his own job in life, right? I said, no, that's the way it is today. You have to say jokes. So here, I'm going to try to say a joke. One religious guy had a break from the yeshiva and he wanted to find a job. So everywhere he goes, there's no jobs. Then he saw an ad. We're looking in a zoo for a guy that is willing to be a monkey for 3 weeks. Say, well, that's good salary, paying good money. He went to the zoo. I came for the ad about the monkey. He said, okay, no problem. You see, this is the custom. You pretend you're a chimpanzee. We put you in a cage. Only 3 weeks. You get your money and you're dismissed. So he said, I'm just curious. Why don't you bring a real chimpanzee? He said, we ran out of budget. We renovated the entire zoo. And we don't have that much money now to buy chimpanzees. In 3 weeks, we're going to have some donations coming in. We'll get a real chimpanzee. We'll let you go. I said, okay, sounds good to me. He got into the cage. First day, he sits over there. He doesn't move. Everybody throws peanuts at him, bananas. He eats. So then he started to like the attention. You know, people like attention. People take pictures, kids are smiling. So he makes a lot of people happy. He said, what a great job. So he started to make all kinds of faces, to jump, to climb on the trees, make flip-flop in the air. Then by mistake, one time he jumped and he fell to the other cage. And he saw the lion. The lion is starting to come closer and closer. He said, wow, what a mistake I made. Just when the lion is coming, and everybody in the zoo screaming, help! He's about to kill the monkey. So he said, Hashem, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Everyone's listening to the monkey saying Shema Yisrael. Then the lion say, Baruch Shem Kvod Malchuto The lion. Then from the third cage, someone say, you fools, be quiet. They're going to fire all of us. Ezu, if Hashem wanted to make you a chimpanzee, to have females, to have food, to sit in the sun, to jump, to do sport, he will make you a monkey. He made you an intelligent human being with a soul. You have big responsibility. Comes Moshe Rabbeinu after 550 prayers, Hashem says it's too late for you. When you had an opportunity to make repentance, you took it for granted. Piece of cake. I saved the entire nation in 1 hour. I cannot save myself in an hour. It's too late. You missed the train. Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu! Why I'm telling you this story? Moshe Rabbeinu, the Torah says he made 5 mistakes in his life. In 120 years, 5 mistakes is nothing. We do it in a minute. In 120 years, why did Hashem did not erase it? Because the Torah is the truth. We are not Christians to cover it under the rug. Comes the Goyim, the philosopher, the historians, they write, the most objective book in history is the Torah of the Jews. The Goyim. I have it in my computer, I can show it to you. We never found any objective book like the Torah of the Jews. All the positive and the negative combined into one book about the heroes. You hear all the bad about King David and King Solomon and King Saul and the prophets. Who killed who spoke Lashon Hara, who is righteous, who is wicked. Because it's the word of God. God does not tell lies. He's not a politician. He's not covering things under the rug. You know, I got into a mood of jokes now. I hope it's not contagious. You know the joke. One politician, he promised his people, you know, all kinds of things, you know. So what happened to him? So when he dies, they told him,
you know, you're important. You were an important prime minister. Where do you want to go? You want to go to heaven or you want to go to hell? So he say, can I see first? He say, sure. So they take him to hell. He see bars, yachts, jet ski, tourists all over, everyone with suntan, beautiful restaurant. We say, what, that's hell? Couldn't be better. Then they say, can you take me also to heaven? I want to see what's going on over there. So yes, no, they say in heaven, everyone like this, with black hats, yeshiva, Amma, Rabbi Akiva, so this is heaven. Take me back to hell. So you sure? So what's the question? This is my ideal life. Take me back. He said, no problem. He opened up the gate. He comes in. He see desert, thorns, heat, miserable people. And he said, well, where is the bars? He said, that was before the election. Before the election, everyone is fancy, nice. After the election, he doesn't remember who you are. Comes the Torah. The Torah says, pay attention. How do you know? If there's anybody here in the crowd that have a doubt if the Torah really was received from God, here is the proof. I give you in every line here a proof. Proof, not stories. Here. It says like this. Vata Israel, and now Israel, listen to the laws and to the sentences that I'm teaching you to do. Leman tichyu, that you should live. What do you mean I should live? What do you mean? What, someone who doesn't listen to the laws of God, he does not live? Hitler didn't live? Ahmadinejad in Iran doesn't live? Arafat did not live? So why the Torah said, if you want to live, you have to listen to my laws? Apparently what God calls life and what we call life is two different things. What we call life is not really life for God. That the animals also have this kind of life. That's not considered life. Life means something different. Life means here, right here in the Torah. V'atem advekim b'Hashem Elokechem chayim kulchem hayom. You want to be alive, you have to be connected to me 100%. That's life. You disconnected, you're partially dead. Spiritually, we're not talking physically. So comes the Torah and say, pay attention. Your eyes saw what God did to all the people who went after the Goyim and bowed down to the idol. They used to have a huge idol. It's called Baal Peor. Believe it or not, people had great, great temptation to worship idols 3,000-4,000 years ago. There was the strongest desire at that generation. Like today, people steal a lot, speak Lashon Hara, doing sins with women. That's really the temptation of this generation today. In the old days, people were crazy about all kinds of magics and kishufim and idols. That was the trend then. Everyone was involved with this almost. People went nuts to go to, they stand on lines for days to worship some idol. So the Jews, they heard the voice of God only a few days ago. A month or two later, what do? The Goyim put a big idol, and you know what was the Avodah Zarah? They take their bathroom, what they just made, and then bring it into that idol. That was the Avodah Zarah. I once asked my Rav, I don't understand. I mean, we're talking people are very intelligent, very knowledgeable in Torah. It's not today's generation. I would not do such a foolish thing. You give me $1,000,000, you tell me go bow down to an idol. This looks simple to me, stupid to me. Wow. How did it happen to them that they worship idols? You know what the answer is? The idols were talking. What do you think the sin of the golden calf was? They really that dumb. All of a sudden they see a cow from gold and they say, this is the God of Israel. This is the God of Israel. You really think that was the case? You have to open the oral Torah. He opened up his mouth and say, I'm the God that took you out of Egypt. The golden calf begins to speak. Aaron takes thousands of earrings and gold and bracelet and throw it into the fire. A second later, by a magic, you have a golden calf. Amazing. Next thing, he opened up his mouth and say, I'm the God that took you out of Egypt. They thought this is the way to communicate with God. They started to bow down to the idol. That was the scene. What do you think? All of a sudden somebody brought a statue of Buddha and everybody bowed down to this foolish statue that they just made it 5 minutes ago in 47th Street with the gold over there? No.
We gotta look into the things. Well, people who hurt God, they're gonna bow down to an idol. It wouldn't happen to us. It didn't happen to them. It was a very strong temptation. So comes the Torah and say, how do you know it really happened? Very simple. Moshe gives them the Torah and they open up the Torah. And they read in the Torah. They says like this, your eyes saw what God did to the statue of the Goyim that called Baal Peor. Every Jew that followed that idol, God destroyed him from the nation of Israel. How do you know it really happened? Very simple. If it never happened, if there were not maybe tens or hundreds or thousands, I don't know, they don't say the number. But there were a large group of Jews who followed that idol. If God did not clean them from the Jewish nation, like the Torah says, one of the Jews will rise and say, Mr. Moshe ben Amram, can I ask you a question with all the respect? I'm here every second with you since we came out of Egypt, and me and my friend never saw any Jew died because he worshipped that Baal Peor idol. Anybody saw somebody died, those who went to the idols? Here. He went to the idol yesterday. He's right here. She went to the idol. She's right here. If one of the Jews that went to the idol was alive, you wouldn't have the Torah today. We wouldn't be here. There would not be Bet Gabriel. There would not be 47th Street. You would not have it. No Jews, no nothing, no nothing. Why? It would end right there. Say, excuse me, this is the first mistake in the Torah. You say that God gave it. God does not make mistakes. God says right here to us that everyone who did not listen to him, he punished him. Here, they're right here. Or he would say nobody went to that idol. Where is this nonsense coming from? What do we learn? That they saw. Next line. What's the next line? V'atem advekim b'Hashem Elokechem chayim kulchem hayom. Those who stayed with Hashem, faithful to Hashem, and they did not become ungrateful, they are alive today. Re'e, limati otchem chukim. I taught you what God ordered me to teach you. And you should watch the laws and practice it into action. A lot of people say, Rabbi, believe me, don't look at me like this with my ponytail. I love God. I'm religious in my heart. It's beautiful. My grandfather was a rabbi in Yemen. Believe me. My grandfather, everybody knows he was a Mori. Your grandfather is in heaven. What about you? I'm religious in my heart. I don't eat pork. Believe me, when I go to the Chinese, I only eat chicken. I tell him, make sure you don't give me pork. But the chicken was just cooked in the pot with the oil that they just cooked over their shrimps a second ago. Same thing. Sometimes it sounds foolish. People are really, they mean well, maybe. I don't know, but just to give you an example. So it says here, V'atem advekim b'Hashem Elokechem chayim kulchem hayom. I want you to do, not just to know, not just to know in your heart. V'asitem otam. And what is the first line? Ki hi chochmatchem uvinatchem le'enei ha'amim. If you're going to listen to my Torah and practice it into action, which means you walk with a yarmulke and tzitzit, and you walk to shul, and you stand in the street once a month and you do Birkat HaLevana, and the goyim will look at you. What do you think in your heart? They probably think I'm crazy. I went 2 months ago to Dallas, Texas. People tell me, be careful. If they know you're Jew, they will look for your horns in Dallas. That's what they tell them in school, that the Jews have horns. I got nervous a little bit. No, I sit in a plane. I see the guy that worked for the stewardess. He's working for the Delta airline. He treats me like I'm a king. Every second, sir, what should I bring you? I said, no, I'm okay. No. What do you want? Oh, wait, I know what's the problem. You're looking for something kosher. He goes into the kitchen and brings something. That's good, right? I said, yeah, but come on, don't let me down. He gives it to me. Next thing, you want maybe beer? Beer is kosher. I saw religious people. I said, I started to get nervous. Remember, it's a plane of 50, 60 people. Everyone looks at me like I'm the prime minister. I was wondering, this guy is treating me like a king. Then I go to the airport. I see people pay respect. People very religious over there, Christians. A lot of Christians over there. A lot of them supporters of Israel because of the Torah. So what does the Torah say? Sometimes you may think, because we are trying to be like them, they're going to love us more. The opposite. One Israeli soldier, after the Yom Kippur War, he was a prisoner in Egypt. And he was an artist. He used to paint beautiful pictures, you know. And they put him in prison, and they used to torture the people mentally. So what happened, we have only a few minutes to finish, but I'm going to try to finish. No, we are limited in time. So it says like this, they open up the gate, and I thought they left, the guards were not there. I saw that the door is open. I started to walk in the hallway. I made a turn. Then I saw that there's a way to come under the ground. I opened it. Then I found myself in an open field. I started to run. I got to a fence. I saw the few holes in the fence. I said, that's it, I'm running out of here. In few minutes, I'm going to be somewhere in the street, and somehow I'm going to get to Israel. Just when he got to the fence, a jeep came and said, you fool, what do you think? We're that dumb. We're going to let you run. This is the way we torture you guys. You know, that's the way it is. You already one step from freedom. I brought him back into the jail and tortured him. And all. He's telling the story. Today he's mentally ill in his house 30 years. Cannot walk, he cannot get married, not his life is destroyed. He sleeps in a little room that the government gave him. You cannot imagine his life, this person. But one of the things he say shocked me. It says like this, after he tried to escape, they told him, now because you try to escape, we have to chop one of your hands. Tell us, we'll give you the choice, we respect you. Tell us which hand you want us to cut. He's thinking, I'm painting pictures, I'm making parnasa, you know, I sell my pictures. Say, chop my left arm. So he says like this, the Arab, the Muslim Arab, he told him, you kalb, know what kalb means? You dog. You want us to cut your left arm? You don't care about Allah tell you to put every day tefillin? The Arab told him, Hashem put words into this Arab mouth. You're willing to give out the covenant that the Jews made with Hashem tefillin? It's a connection between me and the Jew every day. You're willing to give life of eternity for few stupid paintings that you're going to make and sell it for 5 shekels in Tel Aviv? This guy say it. He say what they used to say. How can it be? He respects the Torah more than him? Yes. That's it. In the end, they didn't chop his hand. It was only, you know, one of the ways to destroy them mentally. So the Torah says, be very careful that those things that you saw today in Mount Sinai and what you see and you heard God, they will be removed from your heart and from your head. Do not forget what you see. You should remember it all your life, and you have an obligation to teach your children and the children of your children, which means your grandchildren. Yom asher amata lifnei Hashem Elokecha bechorev. The Gemara say, Amar Rabbi Yosef. Rabbi Yosef, one of the greatest Amoraim in the Gemara. Every rabbi that his name is mentioned in the Gemara, there are many rabbis that their name on purpose are not mentioned. Every rabbi that his name is mentioned in a Gemara, that means he was in the highest level. To such level of Kabbalah and all the secrets of the Torah, that he was able to bring a soul back into a dead body and revive the person. That's how great they were. If they were not able to do it, their name is not appeared. If their father was not righteous, they erase the name of the father. They write the name of the mother. Everything in a Gemara has a lot of secrets in it. It's not just an oral Torah, bringing the laws. It's a lot of secrets over there. So Rabbi Yosef says, Amar Rabbi Yosef, Ilava Yoma, Kama Yosef Ika Beshuka. If not that day that God gave us Torah, how many Yosef you would have on the street like garbage? All over, millions. Now when we have the Torah, there's Yosef here, Yosef there. The idea behind that story is that the Gemara says in Masechet Eruvin, Amar Rabbi Yochanan. Rabbi Yochanan says, אלמלא ניתנה תורה, היינו לומדים דרך ארץ מהחתול והתרנגול. If we would have not received the Torah and that great day that changed the entire history, right? We would have to learn דרך ארץ, ways of behavior and manners from the animals. We would have to learn to how to behave from the cow, from the cat, and from the chicken, from the roosters. How, when a rooster has relation with his female, what does he do? He first comes, he dance around her, they play, how you doing today? Hey, you in a good mood? How you doing? Can I make you something to eat? You know, not right away, hey, what's going on today? You know, they have a final joke for today. One angry Moroccan guy, a goy. All the jokes is about non-Jews, because you're not allowed to say jokes about Jews. You know, Chas v'Shalom, Lashon Hara in the entire community. So one angry Moroccan guy came to his wife in the night of the wedding. And, you know, he had reputation that they had temper, but she didn't see any signs, so she got married with him. So when they got to the house, first night, she's very happy. Ah, the nights of my life, finally I got married. So he take a chair. As soon as she entered the living room, he takes the chair, broke on her head. So she got up. Wow, what's going on? What did I do? He said, nothing. So why are you here? You're beating me up. He said, that's when you did not do nothing. Imagine if you have done something, what would happen? I'm warning you to begin with. Don't play games with me. So, Rimara says we would have to learn how to behave from the animal. So, rooster, how he's nice to his female before he wants to have relation with her. And the cat and the dogs, when they go to the bathroom, they cover it with their back feet. Go to Lexington Avenue tomorrow. Stand one day over there. You see how many people make in the middle in front of millions. They don't cover it. Look at this goyim. Not, you don't have to go there. You go on the Palisades Parkway. And some days that they have traffic, they need bathroom. Fine, it's no problem. People need sometimes bathroom. There's no bathroom. You have to go into the bushes. What are you going to do? It's an emergency. They're not going down. 3 steps to go to hide yourself in between the trees. They stand in the middle of the road in front of thousands of cars. Standing, thousands of cars watching him. And I wonder to myself, what a brilliant Gemara. People without Torah can become worse than animals. Mamash, the Gemara says. Today you take it for granted. The Torah did not say that if you be educated and you have master degrees, the goyim will be impressed by you. No. That did not bring us fame. Nobody ever admired the Jews for all the great discovery that they found in the scientific world. Even though the Jews contributed more scientific proofs and discovery, more than all the goyim together. When they are 99% of the goyim, 99% in the United States is goyim. Only 6 million Jews in America, 2% from the population, they are... The same amount of doctors are Jews, the same amount of doctors are goyim. 98% of the population contributed 50% of the doctors. 2% contributed the same amount of doctors. Same thing, lawyers, judges, business people, minister, anything you want. So the point is, the lion came over there. That's the lion from the joke, you know. So the idea is the Torah said nobody will acknowledge, nobody will admire you because of that. They will admire. Why we call the nation of the book? Am HaSefer. Am HaSefer. The Goyim call us Am HaSefer. Why? Because of Bialik? Because of who? Because of Shakespeare? Whatever the names is? No. Because of the Torah. The nation that published the book of God to every human being. That's what Rabbi Yosef said. That's what Rabbi Yochanan said. Ilava yoma kama Yosef ika beshuka. I want to take the opportunity because time ran out. I did not cover even 10% of the parasha, unfortunately. There's a lot of brilliant things here. One thing you should know, the reason that we sit here tonight in Bet Gabriel, because it says right here, ve'efitz Hashem etchem ba'amim ve'nisharetem b'imtei me'at. If you're not going to listen to me, I will be forced to spread you to the entire world. There are Jews in every country in the world, even in China, even in Afghanistan, there's still one or two Jews. Everywhere there are Jews, everywhere. There's only one nation that have representative in every state, in every country in the world, is the Jewish nation, and the smallest nation. Only 13.2 million Jews. We started together with the Chinese.
They are 2 billion, we are 13.2 million. And every airport that you're gonna go, you hear Hebrew, you hear Bukharian, you hear Yiddish, you see people, God will read Kada, everywhere you go. Sometimes it looks like we are 500 million, only 13 top million. You go, you ask the Goyim, they think Israel is the size of Russia. I'm serious, not a joke. They hear about Israel, everyone knows, they think we are minimum like United States or at least Germany. Tell them, no, Israel is the size of Brooklyn and Queens and Manhattan, that's all. Smaller than New Jersey, especially after they gave the Arab half. Queens, Brooklyn, and Manhattan. That's it. That's Israel. That every minute you hear about it, every minute, the whole world is around the Middle East. Every day they say, we must have peace in the Middle East for the stability of the world. Who cares about the little tribe over there? Why do you care about them so much? The whole world is around that holy place because it's the house of Hashem. Why do you think the Arabs are crazy about getting it? They're that dumb. 99.9% of the Middle East is the Arabs. They're not that dumb. Believe me, they would let us have Queens and Brooklyn and Manhattan just to stop fighting. It's the house of Hashem. Who programmed their head to go after us? Hashem, it says in the Torah, Ishmael, Pere Adam, it's going to be after you as long as you don't listen to me. So listen to me, Ishmael is down. The power of Ishmael, it depends on how we behave. And the Torah says, Hashem etchem ba'amim, I will spread you in all the nation. Look at this prophecy. No human being could write such a book. Ve'nish'artem etei mispar ba'goyim. Only very few of you will survive. Asher yenaheg Hashem etchem shama. But you know, my hand, the hand of God, is directing you in the nations of the goyim. Right here. And what does the Torah say? Close to the end of the world. We are 17 years into this prophecy already. Pay attention to what I say in my beginning today. Batzar lecha. In time of problems. Umetzaucha kol hatzarot ha'ele. And all these tragedies will follow and come to your life. Ba'acharit ha'yamim. In the end of the days. We are close to every second. Ve'shavta ad Hashem elokecha ve'shamata bekolo. You're gonna be forced to return to your God and listen to Him finally. You will be forced. Why? How long are you going to be able to fight against the truth? But there's good end. What's the rest? The next sentence. Veshavta ed Hashem Elokecha, you return to your God and listen to Him because your God is a merciful God. He will not leave you alone. He's always watch over you. And He will not destroy you. Mean permanently. I will not forget the covenant that He made with your father. Who is the father? Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. Because He swore to them. Kish'alna le'yamim rishonim. Go check in the history. There's any nation that announced that God came and spoke to him from the fire like you heard my voice? If the Jews will not hear the voice of God, right there they would stand up and say, excuse me, Moshe, where all these lies are coming from? Where? It says here that I heard God 2 weeks ago. I don't remember hearing him. Everybody would say, he's right, Moshe. Give him an answer, please. Moshe Rabbeinu will be assassinated that day. It will be the end of his life. You come to be our boss, you're fooling us, you bring us book and you say, God gave it to you? How do you know it really happened? Because it says here you heard God and they started to keep mitzvot right there. They would not accept the mitzvot if they didn't hear the voice of God. So God says right here, and I finish with the last sentence for tonight like this. Kish'alna le'yamim rishonim. Go check in the history. There is any time in history that a group of goyim came and claimed that I came and spoke to them? You know what it says here? What it says here proves for those who have intelligence in their head, without a doubt, that no human being was able to write the Torah. How do you know? No human being will be able to write the Torah. Why? Because the Torah promised here against all odds, against all possibilities, no group of goyim will ever claim that I spoke to them. Even if they lie, It will not happen. I will not let the group of non-Jews ever to gather together and make a phony story and claim that I spoke to them in public or in hidden place. I will always avoid it. However, if the goyim will try to pretend that they are prophets and I gave them the Quran or I gave them the New Testament, he will always start with one individual that will never have any witnesses to his story. Never. When Muhammad came from the desert, he did not bring one witness. Only his story. Right away, 50% doubt before it even start. When this Mary, the wife of Yosef the carpenter, Miriam, Jewish woman, she cheated on her fiancé, and she gave the world a gift, JCPenney. And then, what happened? What happened to her? She came, she wanted to save her life. So she said, God came to me in a dream and made me pregnant. I'm a virgin. You know the story, right? There's many, many movies about it already. One question. Did she bring one witness to a story? 80,000 times. People came and brought new religion, new cult. 80,000 times. Not once one of them thought to bring a bunch of witnesses, even to bribe them. 2-3 cousins, here, take $1,000. Just, I need you to say that you saw the angel giving me this book. That's all. And then go back to your life. 2-3 of these friends. Please, we saw a light came from heaven. And this book was put in the hand of our master, this Muhammad, whatever. That's all they had to do. And that would be the end of our Torah. Why? Because the Torah promised here, Kish'alna le'yamim rishonim, go check in the history. The Torah applies to every generation 100% equally. The same thing today, the same thing in the time of Moshe Rabbeinu. Check in the back, in history. Did you ever hear a group of goyim claim that I spoke to them? Not that they bring with... Claim that I spoke to them. It will never happen. You know what would happen? If 100 years ago, there would be 10 Chinese people come from somewhere in the ocean and say we were in the middle of the ocean and God came to us and he gave us this letter or even spoke to us without a book. Even if we know 100% they're lying... It would be a lie in the Torah. Why? Because the Torah didn't promise that the goyim will not get another book. The Torah promised that they will never be able to gather more than one person to claim that God spoke to them. Do you know any human being that was able to take such a risk and write it in a book? Against all odds, against all possibilities, it's impossible. There's no way to predict such a thing. 80,000 times it was always right. Do you know anybody will take a risk to write that the Jews will be less than all the nations when we started with the Chinese in the same generation? Do you know any human being will be able to write that we will be spread in every country all over the world? Who would write such a thing? Every line in this parasha, it's a prophecy. It's a divine words. We read it and we don't see what we read. And tomorrow, after he comes out of shul, he said to the rabbi, Rabbi, prove to me that God really gave the Torah. You just read the parasha yesterday, there are 300 proofs that leave no doubt. That's what Hashem said, Enayim lahem velo yiru, Oznayim lahem velo yishmau. Bezrat Hashem, I will see each one of you next Sunday. I started to thank, so first of all, you know, I thank Bet Gabriel. I'm glad to be here after 2 years. When I used to speak here, I had to move on because they started to renovate that place. And the renovation took a lot of, you know, a few months actually. And I moved on, and Baruch Hashem, with Hashem's help, I'm back here. I hope, Baruch Hashem, a lot of people came today, but I hope even more people. It's a big mitzvah for each one of you for the next Sunday to bring at least 2-3 more guys. The brother Kolyakov, they're doing their best, but you know, there's only 2 people. They have some other people here who helps, but each one of you have the same obligation to bring at least 2-3 friends, cousin, sister, parents.
It's a big mitzvah. You don't know. Jews hear one lecture in this generation, the Torah promise. There will be hunger to search for the word of God. Hunger. And people in today's generation, close to 1 million Jews made repentance. It never happened in history. 20, 30, 50 years ago, you took the head of the generation, the biggest rabbi in the world, before he died. Rabbi, how many Jews you made religious? So, with Hashem help, 3. 70 years he teach Torah, he had an opportunity. I wrote it in a book. 3 people he made religious. Today, every beginner, every speaker that knows a little bit to read and to talk, he gives 1, 2, 3 lectures in his life, he already made more than 3 Jews religious. So everybody asks this question, how can it be? What, he's better than the biggest rabbi in the world? So you know what the answer is? When in construction, when you build a building, what happens? If you have a piece of metal, which is very, very heavy, 2 tons, you cannot move it an inch. 10 people are trying to pick it up, you cannot move it. You bring the tractor with a lift, it picks it up in the air, now it's hanging on a chain. Now you come with your pinky, you move it like this, it turns around. I'm able to move 10 tons? How am I doing it? Before, when it was on the ground, I couldn't move it an inch. 50 people cannot pick it up. Now when the lift is picking it up, you push it, it turns around, you take it, you push it up and down. Well, you can do whatever you want with this. What is this? This is the analogy for what's happening today. In the old generation, the piece of metal was on the ground. It was impossible almost to move it. Now it's in the air. What does it mean? Hashem says that before Mashiach come, he will do 99.9% of the job for the speakers of the generation. He will throw hunger to the heart of every Jew. But there's a free choice. Free choice. All over the world, the Goyim, the Muslims, the Christians, everybody's waking up to search for Hashem. Nobody knows what's the right way to Hashem in a Goyim. They think this way and that way. We have the truth. We are the nation that received the truth from Hashem. Why would we leave an opportunity for life of eternity because of such foolish things around us? Remember, now it's in the air. It's very easy. You have an opportunity. Hashem throw the hunger. V'ishlachti ra'av ba'aretz, Hashem say. I throw hunger to the land. Not hunger for food. Food, Baruch Hashem, every Jew have. Hunger for spirituality. Baruch Hashem, thank you very much. We arrived to this generation. Let's bring our brothers into the lectures. Thank you very much. Good night.